Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. In this video, we're going to look at collecting samples and we're going to look at quality and patient interaction. So quality assessment in the collection process for phlebotomy involves the preparation of a patient for any specimen to be collected, the collection of valid samples, and proper specimen transport to the lab. So quality is really important all over healthcare because what we do affects patients' lives. So the accuracy of lab testing begins with the quality of the specimen that is received by the lab. We have a quirky, funny saying in the lab, but it's true, and it's garbage in, garbage out. So if we do not get a good sample, the test results are completely irrelevant, right? And it could even be harmful to the patient. So this quality depends on how a specimen was collected, transported, and processed by the lab before testing begins. And of course, errors can occur before, during, or after blood collection. And it's important to recognize all the places where errors can occur. In this part of the whole testing process, the whole analysis process, this is what we call pre-analytical errors. This is the part of testing where the most errors do occur. So the leading causes of these pre-analytical errors include patient identification errors, inappropriate specimen collection, tube or container, so getting the wrong type of tube with the additives, and we're going to talk about the difference of those in the next video. The specimen collection tube is not filled properly. That is really important for having the proper anticoagulant to blood ratio to get accurate test. And then test request errors. So that could be the wrong test ordered, or the test was ordered on the wrong patient or for the wrong time or something like that. When collecting blood specimens, it's important that the phlebotomist considers the rights of the patient at all times. And the rights of the patients are based on the patient's Bill of Rights. So this is a law, this is in place in our Bill of Rights in our legislation. So a patient has the right to high quality care, a clean and safe environment. They have a right to be involved in their care, and this can affect phlebotomy because part of their right to be involved in their care is their right to refuse. And so if a patient refuses to have blood work done, then I mean, you can explain to them the purpose of why they need to be tested, but you also have to honor their refusal and document it, obviously, and then let their physician deal with it. They have a right to the protection of privacy, so you shouldn't be discussing anything about that patient at all with anybody unless you are specifically asked and it's for the testing process and it's by somebody that needs to know, and it's not just, you know, your buddy that's wanting to know what's going on. And then they also have the right to help with post-hospital care and help with billing claims. And this is help with like securing post-hospital care and help understanding how billing works and how to file claims, etc. So let's talk a little bit about differences in approaching patients when you want to collect blood or specimens. So for pediatric patients, it is very important to understand the process and to be really gentle and patient with children. Involve the parents in the process, especially if the parents are willing to be involved. Don't be in a hurry and get help. So I worked in, did phlebotomy on children for many, many, many years, and I never went to stick a child without a helper of any kind, and we did involve the parents if the parents were willing to be involved in restraining the child, usually putting the parent at the head where the child is so they can interact with the child and talk to them. And then one helper would help keep the arm still if we were doing a venipuncture while the other person stuck the patient. And it's really important to understand with pediatric patients, you can have a whole range of reactions. There are some pediatric patients that are really cooperative, and then there are some that are going to be very combative. All right, for adolescent patients, do be alert to possible anxiety. They'll be more likely to try to hide it. Make sure you give them eye contact and don't rush to process, you know, talk to them. For adult patients, do tell them what to expect. Be honest, right? Be courteous and tactful. Keep their information confidential. They are really, I mean, that should be all the time, but for adult patients, that's really, really important. And same for geriatric patients, but respect their beliefs and engage in conversation if the patient seems willing. They could be, you know, if they're not engaging in conversation, they could be just too sick or not feeling good or just really not wanting to do chit chat. So remain pleasant, and this is remain pleasant even if your patient is being rude and grouchy and just taking it out on you. You still need to remain professional and pleasant. And then always leave the hospital room as you found it. There's nothing more aggravating if you are stuck in a hospital bed and you had everything set up the way you needed, and then somebody comes in to draw your blood and moves everything away from the bed and then does not put it back the way it was. And then here you are stuck in the bed and you can't reach your cell phone, you can't reach your water. It's really aggravating and very frustrating for the patient. So always leave things as you found them, and you can even ask them before you leave if there's anything that they need, anything that you can do for them. For your geriatric patients, dignity and respect are going to be very important. Be more formal. They're often in a generation where calling people by their first name is just not done, especially if you're not familiar. And so they would want to be called Mr. or Mrs. so-and-so by their last name. Be aware of hearing difficulties, and if they have hearing difficulties, speak lower, as in a lower pitch, not a high pitch, right? But louder. And that's because the higher pitch sounds frequencies are the first to go in hearing. So use a deeper voice and a little bit louder as you can without sounding too weird, right? And last, we're going to look at some challenges. So a phlebotomist must never proceed with a procedure until the obstacles have been remediated. So difficulties could be simply finding a patient, especially during the daytime. Patient might be in therapy, patient might be in MRI or in CT or somewhere, or maybe they move them to transfer them to a different room, right? So sometimes it's chasing patients down, finding out where they are. And another difficulty could be identifying a patient under difficult circumstances. I've seen often when they come back from surgery, their armbands have been removed. In the hospital I used to work at, they used to tape them to the bed. And then the patient is maybe still under some sedation. So it's, you know, those are difficult circumstances to get a correct ID on that patient. And you do have a right to ask for them to re-armband the patient so that you can properly identify them, especially if the patient is still unconscious. So patients themselves, of course, can also present a challenge. So just like I said, either sleeping or unconscious patients. So if they're sleeping, you need to wake them up. But then since you need to properly identify them and they need to tell you who they are, you really need to kind of get them awake and with it where they understand what you're doing and they can answer your questions. If they are unconscious, then you have to make sure you can properly identify them. And be aware that there could be any kind of reaction when they're unconscious. They could move without you expecting them to. And then, of course, apprehensive patients, even in adults, there are patients that, you know, aren't looking forward to getting stuck. There are patients that maybe have had bad experiences with getting their blood drawn, and so they can be apprehensive. And there are patients that could have a language barrier. So the more languages you can speak, and the better it is for your interface with patients. And then lastly, there can be some combative patients. Always get help with the combative patients, just like we talked about with a combative child, but also be really aware for your own safety of things that they can grab. So for example, like I might would even take my glasses off if I can function without them, because they might could grab my glasses. Right now my hair is halfway up, but if you have long hair, you'd really want to have it pulled back, because there's a chance that they would grab and pull on your hair. If you have an ID badge that's on a lanyard, they could pull on it and try to strangle you. If you have it that's on a reel that pulls away and back. They can also, they can grab it, let go, and it can smack you in the face, or they can grab it and can try to strangle you if they're really being mean. So be like aware of all the potential harm that can come to you because they are combative, and you do want to, you know, work in as safe as possible environment and have somebody in there with you if they're being combative. So the next video is going to be more on the sample collection itself and the different tubes, etc., and their additives. So stay tuned, and I thank you for your attention.